Good evening and welcome to Hampton Beach Area Commission's monthly meeting. Let me start by asking everybody to stand, say the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, well, let me introduce the commissioners and welcome back after hopefully a very successful and a healthy summer. To my far left, Mr. Preston, Bob Preston, representing the Chamber of Commerce. Rich Renier, representing the Hampton Beach Village District. Dean Merrill, Commissioner at Large. Mike Hausman, representing DRED. Ann Marchand, our Secretary. John Nyan, representing the Town of Hampton. Bill Watson, representing Department of Transportation. Chuck Rage, representing the Hampton Beach Village District. Fran McMahon, representing Rockingham Planning Commission. And Rick Griffin, representing the Town of Hampton. Do we have any public comment? Hearing none, I would like to, before we go to the appointments, go and review and approve the minutes of a variety of meetings. Because some of them have to do with the appointment with Gordon Liddy tonight with transportation. So with that, the first set of meeting minutes was May 21st, monthly meeting. Page one. Page two.
It's okay.
Page three. Page four. Page five. Hearing no changes or edits, I'll entertain a motion to accept. Motion made by Mr. Hausman, second by Mr. Preston. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you. The next meeting that we had is a special public meeting on June 11th, which focused on the Hampton Beach potential transportation improvements, which was a public hearing regarding our transportation grant. Page one. Page two. Page three. And page four. Hearing no changes or edits, I'll entertain a motion to accept the minutes of June 11th. Motion made by Mr. Rage, second by Mr. Griffin. Any further discussion? All in favor? Opposed? Thank you. Next is a special meeting that we had July 24th. Had to do with a pilot project with the Hampton Police Department. We had a number of our commissioners present and Mr. Griffin by conference call. Page one, page two. Hearing no changes or edits, I'll entertain a motion for approval. Motion made by Mr. Merrill, second by Mr. Griffin. Any further discussion? All in favor? Opposed? Thank you very much. Okay, on our appointment schedule today is Gordon Liddy, who, as we all know, is handling our transportation grant for the New Hampshire Department of Transportation. William Rose was unable to attend tonight due to a conflict in meetings, but we have our own Mr. Watson, who will also jump in somewhat wearing two hats tonight, one as a commissioner and one as Gordon's partner in terms of representing DOT. So, Gordon, welcome back to Hampton. And I have already told the commissioners that this will not be a one-hour meeting tonight, but it won't be a three-hour meeting either.
Right.
So,
thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I wanted to thank you for the opportunity to come and kind of lead you through what I'm calling what I did this summer. We've been hard at work developing analyses of existing conditions and traffic patterns, as well as looking at options for the future. So I just wanted to kind of recap a little bit what we've been up to in terms of public outreach and what the results of that were, and then I can lead you through the alternatives that we have developed. So, So you may recall in the 2001 Hampton Beach master plan, there were a number of transportation recommendations, and they included reconstruction of the bridge over the Hampton River, reconstruction of Ocean Boulevard to be a one-lane, one-way north facility, reconstruction of Ashworth Avenue to be a three-lane facility with two-way traffic and a center turn lane, one-way circulation on side streets, and then reconstruct intersections at the beach gateways, which are Highland Avenue and Church Street on Ocean Boulevard. Some of these things have been accomplished. The one-way circulation has been done. There was a major kind of infrastructure program that reconstructed many of those streets, but very little of the other improvements have taken place to date. There was also a recommendation to install several traffic signals, including at the State Park driveway, at Ashworth and Ocean on the south end, four signals along Ashworth Avenue, and then at Highland Avenue. And there was also an interesting kind of notion of creating these pedestrian crossing zones on Ocean Boulevard, primarily in the area of the Seashell and the casino, where there's a huge amount of pedestrian traffic. And then also providing a remote parking facility with a free shuttle service to the beach. So, you know, we reviewed those recommendations, and we had a public information meeting, which you just approved the minutes for, in June. And we went through the recommendations that came out of the master plan previously, some of the existing conditions information that we had gathered in the spring. And we had a kind of public small group session that out of which came a couple of recommendations to look into in much greater detail. The top priority, and these are kind of listed in the order in which they were prioritized by the group that was here at that meeting. The top item is dealing with sidewalks and pedestrians, particularly on Ocean Boulevard, and making that a safer and more accommodating kind of place for people to walk around. Parking availability was an issue. Directional signage and wayfinding around the beach, it was thought, would perhaps improve utilization of the facilities that are available. There was discussion of sort of general traffic congestion, particularly on exiting the beach in the afternoon, and then deficiencies with the Hampton Harbor Bridge. So we took that information and we started thinking about what all of that meant in terms of what we found in our projections of traffic volumes and the counts that we had done last year, taking those, projecting them into the future with a factor of growth, and we had identified sort of fine-tuned what some of the concerns might be. At the same time, we had some social media outreach with an active page on Facebook. We received many comments. It actually was pretty well attended, actually with John's help, in terms of showing us how to boost our posts, which I frankly is beyond me. But we went from, you know, 25 page views a day to about 1,300 page views a day. So it seemed to have worked. And the, so we had 120 followers, which was, is a pretty good number. Just by means of comparison, VHB did a master plan for the city of Watertown in Massachusetts. It was a year-long comprehensive master plan process, and I believe they had 80 followers. So I feel pretty good about 120. And I can assure you, not all of them are us. there were several good comments that were posted, and we also, which I'll get into in a moment, we posted weekly polls with three or four questions just to sort of maintain traffic on the site, as well as get specific feedback from the site visitors. But the general comments, to the extent we got actual kind of threaded comments, were that a trolley along the beach would be something to think about, that transit service going all the way from Salisbury to Rye could both help reduce congestion as well as get people who might be out at night spots or whatever, get them off the road. Parking garages were suggested. Signalization at Church Street was suggested. Improving crosswalks and pedestrian safety was a common theme, and bicycle accommodation was mentioned. So every week, and there's seven of these slides, I don't think we need to dwell too much on them, but we started out by sort of seeing who on the site was a visitor, who was a resident, and that actually changed over time, where we had this shows that sort of three out of four people were visitors, but over time it kind of morphed into local residents participating in the poll, which I thought was interesting. But trying to get some sort of idea of when people come and what kind of visits they might have. And then we asked if people were residents. This was the second week, part-time resident, full-time resident. How many people live in your household? How many people visit, you know, in your home? And what are the age groups? Then we had, you know, kind of what do you do here when you come? And not surprisingly, and when do you come? So not surprising, there aren't a lot of surprises here. It's the majority of people arrive before 10 a.m. to 12 p.m. And they want to come to the beach. They stay at the beach for 2 or 3 hours, and then they usually have a small family group. So you can sort of see that in observing who's using the beach. When you come, do you usually drive? And the vast majority of people said yes. Where do you park? Well, they in these poll results, most of these people were actually residents of the beach or of Hampton, and they park in resident parking. We asked questions about, would you be willing to pay more to park in central locations? And again, perhaps not surprisingly, people said no. Would you be willing to use a paid trolley? And again, more people than not said no. Would you be willing to use a free trolley? And the yes numbers went way up. Would you be interested in using a smartphone app to see if there's parking available? And a good majority of people said yes. Would you be willing to pay a fee to park in a beach area parking garage? And people said yes. We didn't really say how much the fee might be, but presumably it would be similar to what it costs to park in the beach area today. This is around biking, so do you bike in the Ocean Boulevard or Ashworth Avenue area? And many people said yes. Do you usually feel comfortable, safe, walking and or biking? And it was really kind of more no's than yeses, and was sometimes, you know, I don't feel safe. Do you feel existing bike and pedestrian facilities are adequate? And the vast majority of people said no. Do you feel biking and pedestrian facilities are adequate? What are inadequate? What would you do to improve them? And there were a number of suggestions. And then questions about what activities, you know, the 1, 2, and 3 kind of main activities people like to do, and not surprisingly, again, the first activity that people like is either walking along the beach or using the beach, and then it goes down to where the third highest activity or third main activity would be dining and shopping. So that, again, is consistent with what we see when we look at people using the beach. They're here for the beach, but they use the commercial facilities that are available to them. So we took all of this information, again, as, along with a fairly detailed analysis of traffic operations projected out 20 years into the future with, I think we used a 1% growth rate over time, and looked at what, you know, where the operational difficulties were. We also had pedestrian counts, and pedestrian counts in the main part of the beach, and by main part of the beach I mean sort of in the seashell area, were incredibly high, 2,700 to 3,000 pedestrians an hour. Which is a lot if you're thinking about putting them on a 5-foot sidewalk. So, and, you know, my take on it is that a lot of the congestion, and you see this as you drive through the Ocean Boulevard corridor, a lot of the congestion is really caused by two things. One is that all of the through traffic has to be there. So anybody going from Seabrook to Northampton has to be on Ocean Boulevard, but anybody who's looking for parking down there has to be there. Anybody who is just sort of surveying the scene is going to be there. As much as 15 to 20% of the traffic on Ocean Boulevard at this point is recirculation traffic. So it's people that are either cruising or they're looking for parking or whatever. But they're multiple trips. And the high pedestrian volumes with people just sort of willy-nilly crossing the street creates a lot of delay. So, you know, because obviously the cars have to stop for pedestrians. So once you get, if you're headed northbound, once you get past the casino and maybe past that next block, it's no problem. And traffic volumes, or the congestion anyway, seems to dissipate very, very quickly. So the key area on Ocean Boulevard, I think, is the area between the casino headed south to where Ocean Boulevard makes that turn in by Haverhill Avenue. So we looked at this in sort of three separate sections, because there really are, it really is going to be a kind of mix and match scenario here. So we have Ashworth Avenue, which is one section. We have Ocean Boulevard South, which is basically from Ashworth Avenue on the south all the way up to where Ashworth Avenue takes off up by the Ashworth Hotel. That's Ocean Boulevard South, and then Ocean Boulevard North, which is from the Ashworth up to Boar's Head. And there are a couple of different alternatives for each, some of which are interdependent, but they're largely independent of one another. So, you know, if we're thinking about doing improvements, it's important to think about how we're going to implement these, and, you know, considering that, you know, $20 million is not going to just show up one day. And we're going to have to think about how best to dedicate the funding that might be available in any given, you know, 3-year period, say. So starting with Ashworth, and I know these are a little bit difficult to see, but you have copies of them in your report, and I can certainly supply you with larger copies of them. This section is the existing section on Ashworth Avenue. You've got a sidewalk, you've got a shoulder area that is not typically used for parking. There are a few parking spaces next to the market, but the rest of it is posted with no parking, but the space is there. Then you have two travel lanes southbound. You have a widened shoulder that really functions as a bike lane, and then you have another sidewalk. So that's the existing section. And the existing section, the right-of-way, you should know, is between 47 and 55 feet wide. There are, for the majority of it, it's just under 50 feet wide. So, and there are a few constrictions where it appears, you know, we don't have survey information on right-of-way and building locations. We have sort of tax maps and GIS building locations. But it appears as if there are a few encroachments into the right-of-way. I don't know at this point whether they're actual buildings or whether they're just porches or what. But we have proposed a couple of different alternatives. One is to maintain the two-way southbound, essentially maintain the existing section, but improve the consistency of the roadway. Because right now, it's kind of variable width. The sidewalks are certainly variable width. And in many cases, the utilities are in the sidewalks, and they are inaccessible to people with mobility issues. They don't meet ADA standards, for example. There aren't tip downs everywhere on the corners. So this is kind of a minimal improvement scenario with a 5-foot sidewalk, an 8-foot shoulder area, two 11-foot lanes, a 5-foot bike lane or widened shoulder, and a 5-foot sidewalk. This alternative B is a two-lane or three-lane two-way facility that would have the 5-foot sidewalks, a 2-foot shoulder, 11-foot lane, a 12-foot center turn lane, an 11-foot northbound lane, 2-foot shoulder, 5-foot sidewalk. And then in addition to that, we're saying that there should be a 2-foot utility strip on either side outside of the sidewalk. So if you add all of that up, it's 52 feet. So in many cases, this is more width than we have available to us. And so what we're looking at right now is taking a little bit of a more detailed look at the right-of-way conditions to see if there are ways we can sort of skinny this down to fit within the existing right-of-way. Because the more kind of takings you might have, the more complex and expensive and controversial a project like this might be. So we're looking hard at ways to, like I said, sort of neck this down. One option would be, instead of doing this 2-foot utility panel, doing the 5-foot sidewalk and putting the overhead utilities right on the back of the sidewalk, in the sidewalk, which would still allow, say, a 3'6" clear area between the curb and the utility pole, so that it would meet ADA standards. And we think that in the majority of cases, if we can do that, we can make this happen without impacting any private property. So the two alternatives, which if you want to take a more detailed look at this, I have a PDF that shows these in more detail, and you have these drawings in your package. But alternative one is to provide a 2-lane one-way southbound facility with sidewalks and a bike lane, and signalize the intersection of Ocean Boulevard on the south, so that that will do a couple of things. It will tend to meter traffic onto Ocean Boulevard, and it also would make that intersection a safer area for pedestrians. The second option is to do the 3-lane section, where we have a center turn lane. We have one lane northbound, one lane southbound, the center turn lane. And the center turn lane is there for two reasons. One is that it accommodates left turns into the letter streets without sort of clogging up the through lane. And it also allows somebody who's making a left turn, a southbound turn, out of one of the lettered streets to have sort of an area of refuge where you can do a sort of a two-part turn. You don't have to cross two lanes of traffic necessarily. You can turn into the center turn lane and then merge into the traffic. So it improves both safety and operations that way. And so it would come out of the north. There would be one lane southbound, one lane northbound, and that center turn lane. In that case, you also need to do the signal at Ocean Boulevard. You also need to include a sort of a slip lane turn lane in that location as well, which isn't necessary if all the traffic is kind of going that way. In Ocean Boulevard, and we'll talk about some of the design nuances here in a moment, this is the existing section where you have a 5-foot sidewalk. You've got about an 8-foot striped loading area that functionally is, you know, people walk there. But they also actively use it for loading. We were out there and, you know, it was noontime during the week, but the beach was packed, and so you've got all these people walking around trying to find something to eat, and this semi-truck shows up. I don't know what the heck he was doing there at noon on a Wednesday, but there he was, kind of nudges the pedestrians over and pulls in and starts doing his thing. That's not, as you can imagine, an ideal situation from a safety or an operational standpoint. So in any case, we've got two through lanes. There is a small shoulder, and then you've got this on-street parking that takes place basically between Haverhill and it's formalized between Haverhill and the playground. And then the on-street parking disappears, and you have head-in parking further north from there. And then we've got the new parking lot at the State Beach, which is 90-degree parking. It's one-way northbound. So we've developed a couple of alternatives. One is that you could maintain the two lanes. Unless you make Ashworth two-way, you almost need two lanes on Ocean Boulevard, because you're carrying that through traffic on Ocean Boulevard, so you have increased volumes. So if you did two lanes, it's going to be, I think, absolutely critical to improve the sidewalks on Ocean Boulevard. And my opinion is that you need 10 or 12 feet of sidewalk in order to deal with the pedestrian volumes that are out there, especially between, say, D Street and Haverhill Avenue, because that's where the majority of the pedestrians are. What we're proposing is that you consider doing that 10, 12-foot sidewalk, and then you also need a loading area, so because you can't have trucks just pulling up into the through lane. So this section shows a 12-foot sidewalk, an 8-foot, what we're calling a flex zone, and I'll explain what we think that is in a moment. This has two northbound through lanes and a bike lane. That sidewalk area has got to come from someplace, and where it would come from in this scenario is the on-street parking. So, and I know that that is an issue, but we have some other solutions as well. But in this scenario, we would eliminate the on-street parking in that section of Ocean Boulevard, and we would have two through lanes. Another option would be to do...
Gordon, can I just interrupt for
one
second?
Yeah, absolutely.
Just for clarification purposes, we know there is a difference in width of Ocean Boulevard from Haverhill Street up to D Street.
Yes.
Which is at the end of the casino.
Yep.
Then it opens up.
Yes.
Is this proposal, what impact does it have on D Street North?
It would have no impact.
Okay, so you're just talking from Haverhill Street to...
Correct.
Okay.
There are, I counted them, I believe there are 60 parking spaces between Haverhill, on-street parking spaces between Haverhill and the where that little state park parking area is by the
Chamber
playground.
Of Commerce. Yeah. Yep. Okay.
So some of them are motorcycle spaces. And there are options for recovery of some of those spaces, depending on what other options we might have.
Okay. Sorry for the interruption.
Oh, no problem. I mean, just on that, if you go back to the Ashworth Avenue scenario, since I think the only way that the two-lane northbound makes sense is if you have a two-lane southbound Ashworth, you could potentially meter some spaces on Ashworth where there is no parking today. So, you know, I haven't run the numbers, but I could. I mean, there are probably, I don't know, there's at least as many parking spaces available there as there would be eliminated here. So, okay. You know, that, and that's basically a block away.
Yeah, but one's a town and one's a state.
One's a town and one's a state.
Right, right, right.
And that's about $70,000, I would say, if you took 60 spaces off.
Right.
Per year.
I get that. I mean, I just sort of guesstimated what the revenue would be, and you guys could probably give me much better information, but I estimated $1,440 a year in parking revenue.
$70,000 for that, I would say.
For 60 spaces, yeah. So that's not that far off. I mean, the numbers that you'll see in my evaluation matrix were based on $1,440 a year in revenue.
So it's probably more than that.
So the other option would be to make Ocean Boulevard one lane, do the sidewalk improvements, put the bike lane in, and keep the parking. But you really can only do the one lane northbound if you include the other northbound lane on Ashworth. So you know, one alternative would be to phase these improvements and for some temporary amount of time eliminate the parking on Ashworth, I mean on Ocean Boulevard, shift the lanes over, do the sidewalk improvements, and then at some future date when you do the Ashworth Avenue improvements, you can like move them back over and put the parking back in. So there are a lot of, this isn't easy. No one ever said it was going to be easy, but the message here is that I think the sidewalk improvements are critical because it's going to help, it's going to improve safety. There were a lot of comments that we received about safety issues, and John, I'd be interested to know after I'm done, perhaps you can give me an update or give everybody an update on the pilot program that you guys
That's on the agenda.
But you know, pedestrian safety I think is a real issue, and if we can reduce recirculation and actually reduce the width of road that the pedestrians have to cross, I think that it would be, I think it's going to operate fine. I think that it's going to be a big improvement, and having the streetscape improvements is going to just sort of make everybody feel better about the beach. So these two alternatives, this is the two-lane, one-way, northbound. And, you know, once you get up past B Street, it necks down to one lane, and we'll talk about why that is later. But the traffic volumes don't really substantiate a two-lane section there anyway. And then this is the one lane alternative. Now, if you have, if Ashworth is two way, then you have, then the through traffic is really out on Ashworth. It's not on Ocean Boulevard, which reduces the volumes there, making Ashworth two-way also makes multiple exit points from the beach available that aren't available today. So you can go out Brown Ave, you can go out Island Path, you can, if you made Highland two-way, you could make go out Highland, and that takes all the pressure off of Church Street. So we'll talk about that in a moment as well. But the other thing that happens is that you don't need this to go through. I mean, it could go through, depending on what you do up at Highland Avenue, but you don't need Ocean Boulevard to go through. So if you made Ocean Boulevard one lane, one way, northbound, you could actually close it off at A Street, let people filter out to Ashworth Avenue, and it would turn Ocean Boulevard over to real beach users. It explicitly takes all of the through traffic out of that system, and gives it over to the users of that neighborhood, the patrons of the businesses, as well as the people that are parking there and using the beach. So, I mean, that's another little nuance here.
How do you merge at the top of where Ashworth and the ocean connects, if you're going to one lane?
They're
going to take three lanes into one?
No, this...
That reminds me of going to Boston.
No, this is two lanes, and it goes down to one. So in this scenario, you know, you could have, in this scenario, Ashworth is two lanes northbound, all right? So, and I'll... hang with me just a moment, and this might make more sense to you, because we'll talk about what we're proposing north of the Ashworth. right now, on Ocean Boulevard North, you've got two lanes northbound, two lanes southbound, and you've got this, you know, angled parking in the center. And there is a boardwalk on the east side, and there is a sidewalk on the west side. What we're proposing here is that at least for a limited section of Ocean Boulevard between the Ashworth Hotel and Church Street, that we move the parking to the east. So we consolidate those lanes, and we have, excuse me, one lane northbound, one lane southbound, a center turn lane to accommodate the turning movements. And then we have 90-degree parking like we do down at the State Beach. There are a couple of things that this does for you. One is it really simplifies and clarifies all of the movements associated with the roadway. Because right now, think about it, you have to go up sort of counterintuitively. You have to drive through this parking lot, and then you get to another roadway that you then have to navigate to get across. This, you can't signalize those intersections without doing something like this, because you can't make the signal systems work. So this allows you to signalize the intersections. It also would allow you to, excuse me, put in a roundabout if that was something you wanted to entertain. And it also gives you about 20% more parking than the angled configuration does. So here's where you would pick up a fairly significant amount of parking in this location. And I don't have it at the tip of my tongue, but I want to say it's, you know, 50 or so parking spaces in that area. If you carried this all the way down to Boar's Head, you'd get about 108 additional parking spaces. But because of where this is and how it's presently configured, the majority of it's either 45 or 54 parking spaces in this area. We could also do a dedicated lot in this location to take care of the Ashworth, because I know they use that area for their patrons, and they're probably wanting to, you know, maintain the ability to do that. We do have space in this location to accommodate that. This shows that one lane coming off of Ocean Boulevard, and we signalize Highland Avenue, and then the through traffic goes through. We have a center turn lane, so we've got plenty of queuing here, and we signalize the Church Street intersection. So this is one way of thinking about it, and it could be accommodated either with the Ashworth Avenue two-way or the one-way loop as we have it today. It gets a little bit complicated when you think about having Ashworth two-way and how do you deal with the traffic from Ocean Boulevard coming in. But if Ashworth Avenue is two-way, that demand is a lot lower. The demand from Ocean Boulevard is a lot lower. But at the end of the day, this scenario puts a roundabout, a single lane roundabout, at the end of Highland Avenue. This is dependent on a couple of things. One is it's dependent on making Highland Avenue two-way. It's also dependent on having Ashworth Avenue two-way. The reason being that in order to make a single lane roundabout work at this location, you need to reduce the volumes of traffic enough by providing alternate ways of getting off of the beach to allow this to handle those traffic volumes. And in fact, if you made Ashworth two-way and did this roundabout in this location, making Highland two-way, the demand at Church Street would go down enough that you wouldn't even need a signal there. I mean, the demand would, most of the people would have left the beach before they got to Church Street. And as you know, the intersection at Church and Ocean Boulevard is extremely constrained. There's no way to make any improvement there without taking somebody's property. And it's a 12-foot travel lane, and it's two, like, 3.5-foot sidewalks. So, on a slope. So it's a very difficult existing condition. So, I mean, I think this is attractive from a number of different aspects. One is that it creates a real sense of arrival at the beach. So you're coming down Highland Street, you get to this roundabout, it's an opportunity to do some landscape treatments and some directional signage, and you know, you've just arrived someplace. And we could also kind of reconfigure the area around the Marine Memorial to provide kind of a plaza effect and, you know, do something really attractive there. It's attractive now, but it would have a little bit more space around it.
But once again, for that to work, Highland would have to be two ways. Have you done any study? Is there room for two lanes?
On Highland?
Yeah.
It's two lanes now.
Well, it's a tough two lanes.
Tight, yeah, it's a tough two lanes.
Yeah, I mean, I think you could. The answer is yes.
Okay.
There's parking. What we have not gotten to the bottom of, because we don't have traffic counts there, is the intersection of, and I don't even know what the street is, if you come up to the end of Highland, the westerly end of Highland, there's a cross.
Brown.
Is that Brown?
Brown, yeah.
Okay.
Brown, yeah.
So sign. Brown at Church Street, because you'd have to make a right-hand turn and then a left-hand turn. So we need to understand a little bit more about what has to happen there,
okay.
but the traffic volumes, I think, would be okay.
Okay.
And you know, we can maintain this parking, and in fact, we can increase the amount of parking that's available in that lot that the Ashworth Hotel uses today. And this is kind of one of the reasons why we don't have Ocean Boulevard going through in this scenario, because you've got one lane coming northbound off of Ashworth. You would have to do a merge or an intersection or something like that just as you're going into a rolling queue that's going to be at that roundabout. So we think that would be problematic. So that's
what parking lot are you talking about to expand at the Ashworth?
Well, the Ashworth uses several spaces, like they double up cars in front
Which
of the
is,
it's in that triangle right here.
It's right here.
Yeah, that's right. That's where they, you know, the town puts the planters out and so we could formalize that and give them kind of a better situation. Presumably they pay to lease those spaces from someone. I'm not sure who.
The state.
Yeah. So, and then kind of as an added optional kind of thing, you could continue that treatment down to where the turn is made at Boar's Head to provide, you know, I think this would be a pretty significant aesthetic upgrade. But also it gets about 50 additional spaces by doing this. I think we need to take a close look at how much this costs versus what the benefit might be, because it's probably, you know, it's probably $2 million worth of work to do this. So I would personally think that this would be at a relatively lower priority. And speaking of priorities, in your package, and I actually have copies of these that you might be able to read.
Have enough?
I think so. Kind of took a crack at establishing, you know, what the different alternatives were and what some of the evaluation criteria might be. Mm-hmm. And those are based on kind of what came out of the public input process, pedestrian safety, bicycles. I mean, now I can't see this thing, so. But we evaluated a number of different criteria, and we can, you know, if the commission wishes, we can, thank you, we can add to this, yeah, deficiencies, traffic deficiencies, convenient parking, pedestrian safety, and bicycle accommodation. And in the section below, we have a number of kind of additional factors, including cost and impacts to the seawall and the beach and impacts to or water quality treatment, impacts to parking supply, how much right-of-way displacement there might be in any of these alternatives, aesthetic benefit, and I, as I said, I took a crack at parking revenue impact. It sounded like I was, you know, at least in the ballpark, and for comparison purposes, I think it's a useful number. And the red, yellow, green are kind of an admittedly subjective assessment of, you know, how well each one of these alternatives might meet these address these criteria. So I think this is a useful tool of kind of sorting out in your own mind what the, you know, what it all means. The improvements that we've outlined here cost by segment anywhere between say $1.8 million and $6.5 million. So each segment is assigned a cost. Obviously the do nothing approach on Ashworth is the lowest at, you know, a little north of $1.5 million. And the full-blown redo all of the southern part of Ocean Boulevard is about, we're estimating about $6.5 million. So, which I think was consistent with the numbers you've been tossing around, Mr. Chairman. So we are in the process of fine-tuning these costs at this point. This is, I'll caution you that this is a planning level estimate, and you know, we really don't have any design to price at this point, but I think it again gives you a good sense of what kinds of what the ballpark costs might be and what they are relative, what the options are relative to one another, because we use the same methodology on each alternative. Other items, I think that it's pretty clear from the numbers that were supplied to us by the Rockingham Planning Commission, as well as just observation, that the state park parking lot is underutilized. Trolley service could make that a much more attractive alternative. I guess the question is, who would pay for that trolley, and how would that be, you know, how would that operate? I think there may be an opportunity for modifying parking rates based on convenience and proximity to the beach. So, you know, if you've got the A parking space, then maybe you should pay a little bit more for it. And that would, again, kind of move people toward less expensive alternatives. And it's also very clear that, that wayfinding signage is desperately needed, because when you get to the beach, there's no way of figuring out where you're going if you're not, you know, really familiar with it. In terms of urban design, you know, I think it's really pretty simple stuff. We should utilize a consistent palette of street furnishings. We should put more trash cans out there. We should put more places for people to congregate, benches and so forth. We should consider using modern street lights and, you know, reducing operating costs and maintenance for the owners of those systems. We should, I think the critical issue is the sidewalk and streetscape area on Ocean Boulevard, as, you know, I'm sure you agree. And gateway enhancements as a way to physically mark the notion of arrival and departure from the beach are needed. And just to give you a taste of what we've been considering, this is obviously not in northern New England, but it's a really interesting idea, I think. This happens to be in Mountain View, California. It is a downtown street called Castro Street. And what they've done is they've limited the area for cars to pass to and forth. This is a two-way facility, but it's one lane on either side. And then they have this flex zone, which is in here. It's the same pavement as the sidewalk, which I think is very, very important, because it reads as something different than the street. Right now, the situation on Ocean Boulevard is you have, you know, it's all black pavement, and the only thing separating you from the guy in the car is a painted yellow line. This has drainage. This actually has a trench drain all the way along here, but you could do gutters, you could do street tree, you know, street box filters, you could do any number of drainage facilities. And then this area in between the curb and this gutter is used for a variety of things. In some places, they put sort of temporary barriers out, and they put tables and chairs out there and use it for cafe space. In some areas, they do head-in parking or other kinds of parking. As you can see, there are trees growing out of the middle of this. I don't think that's a good idea in northern New England, but I think some limited number of trees along that corridor will help bring the scale of the streetscape down to a pedestrian level, and doesn't necessarily have to impact anybody's view. And then you have the sidewalk back here. So this is just sort of one of the ideas that we're kicking around, creating a flexible streetscape that can be used perhaps at different times of the year for different things. I just think it's an interesting notion, and one that we should consider. But certainly in Ocean Boulevard, the treatment of the streetscape and making improvements to the pedestrian facilities is, in my opinion, the most pressing, urgent need at this point. And so that actually concludes my presentation.
Yeah. Before we get to questions, yeah, let me just clarify to the commissioners. In talking with Bill and Gordon earlier tonight, this presentation was meant for our eyes as being the project lead, if you will, the owners of this project, for us to look at and just to kind of start getting a feeling for the different alternatives. What's going to come from this discussion tonight is looking at a date where we bring back public officials and the public for comment on this presentation. And so that I don't want anybody to think after they leave here tonight that this is the recommendation, this is a starting point.
Right.
And I think in terms of all of the alternatives that Gordon has come up with, some of which could be customized and mixed and matched, if you will. But I just want to make sure that we clarify that, especially even with the people that are watching TV live, that this is a first initial presentation. It will have to go through a variety of different steps in terms of review, including another public meeting, getting our public officials involved here in Hampton, et cetera, et cetera. So I just want to make sure I clarify that, and now I can open it up for questions. Bob?
Would you just pop back to that Ocean Boulevard picture that's there?
Yep.
Please.
You're talking about the California thing?
No, the one where you're talking about the two lanes and the bigger sidewalk and taking away Michael's parking.
Okay.
Thank you.
I actually can pull that up here. Wait a minute.
Well, I'll start, and you can keep looking. But I look at the Ashworth Avenue and two lanes and all the stuff that's happening down there, and putting all those extra cars down there is kind of a hot mess, because I don't think Ashworth Avenue is the best looking part of Hampton Beach. Ocean Boulevard is the best part of Hampton Beach, and that's what we want to show to our tourists that are coming through. Having said that, we know we have a problem with the sidewalks. They are awful. You know, if you have a puddle in the sidewalk now, you're walking out in the street. And 12-foot sidewalks, I think, are very, very critical.
Do you want the aerial? I mean, because I've got that too.
I think
your alternative configurations, Gordon, that you put up there for your Boulevard South.
All right.
I've had a concern about when we do get to finish off Ocean Boulevard, we're going to end up lowering it. Is it 6 inches, 7 inches when you start?
Yeah, it's probably
pulling out the pavement.
It's probably all of that.
So now we're going to have a lower road, you know, and we're going to have these parking spots that are going to be, you know, on a slant. So if you said, well, when we look at the big picture for Ocean Boulevard, and I know that's down the road a little bit, if you said, all right, we're going to lower Ocean Boulevard, we're going to move the sidewalk, the middle sidewalk down Ocean Boulevard. Now we have
three sidewalks.
We have three.
Right.
So if we lost the middle one, which, you know, I don't know that we need it. The one on the beach is beautiful.
The only reason you need that is because you've got parking along there. If you have parking along there, you need the sidewalk on the east side of Ocean Boulevard. Because otherwise, people get out of their cars, what do? They can't do anything. They have to go across the street.
Can they walk up the bike path till they get to entrance into a parking lot?
It's not ideal.
It may not be ideal, but we don't have enough space.
Yeah.
So if we lost that parking lot, because we're going to end up lowering the road, if we lost that sidewalk, there's 4 or 5 feet there?
There's probably 7 feet.
So if we took Michael's parking and put it along central parking as we see it and had a fence most of that way, and you know, the people may end up walking through the bike path, and they may have to cross the street or go a different way, that might give us the room. Then he doesn't lose those 68 spaces. We picked up
60
spaces. I'm going to find 8 more spaces. I'll show
okay.
you in a minute.
All right.
So I think that would change the whole boulevard, because now we'll have people walking in front of the stores, which is what we want. We either
right.
want them on the stores shopping or on the beach swimming or strolling,
right.
all right? And it would clean up everything in the middle. Now, and that the sidewalks, I can't tell you. You hit that right on the head of how important it is. Chuck will tell you. You know, when you have all the people walking down 4 feet of sidewalks, it's awful.
Well, and you've got, I mean, and
loading and unloading into hotels, they have to pull in front because there's no other place for them.
Right. Right, yeah. And the other thing that happens is, and this is not a criticism, it's just people trying to make a living, but you've got vendors that have their stuff that kind of sneaks out onto the sidewalk, and there just isn't enough space there. and...
But they used to enforce that more. They don't seem to enforce it that way.
So well, but, I mean, it is what it is. It's like you can't fault somebody
there's
for...
There's no delineation between the sidewalk and the roadway either on right. the west side.
Right.
You know, it's all...
Well, and to your point, I mean, I would almost... We don't have cores or anything like that, but just looking at it, I can almost guarantee you that there's 12 inches of asphalt there.
Yeah.
You know, there's probably 4 inches of what was put down back in the 50s or whenever it was they built Ocean Boulevard, this iteration of Ocean Boulevard, and then overlay, and there's no curb left. So there's at least 6 inches of asphalt on top of whatever it was that was there.
So that makes your parking now on the along the road is fairly dangerous, I mean, the way it's going to be. You know, and if they're going to be pulling up Ocean Boulevard, then maybe that's when we can screw around with that sidewalk. You may end up losing a couple of spaces on the boulevard because people might have to walk in through central parking because you don't want to maybe walking the whole strip.
Right.
When you get up to A and B on the left, I don't know how those people would feel about it, but now what we have, I call it police parking.
Yeah.
That is so wide. There's a lot of wasted space. You might find 10 spaces in there that people could pull in, and the street is so wide at that point, they could back out of there and pull back onto the boulevard pretty easily. Mm-hmm. So what you lost on the other end, I think you could pick it up. You know, that Highland Avenue, I don't know, that would be.
Well, we may be able to, you know, if you look at this graphic, what I had tried to do was provide, you see the green space along Ocean Boulevard? You know, it seems like there should be enough room to get a full bay of parking in there. But the problem is that you need more than, you know, a 2-foot separation between that parking and the roadway. And I don't know that we have enough information to really say definitively that it can't be done. But yeah, what I'm saying is to, and I'm doing this because my pointer is just a dot. This configuration, if you could take that down here all the way, if there was enough space here to get a reasonable sidewalk in, say 8 feet or, you know, in that area, because the pedestrian volumes aren't as high as they are further south, you know, you may be able to get, if you could do that, that would be 40 extra spaces.
I think you're right to say, you know, break it up into three parts. You know, we'll just say the Ashworth to the south end, because that's important. You know, that's where most of the pedestrian action is. After you get past that, it's not that big a deal. You know, and I don't even know that it's a problem, you know, from the Ashworth north when you're going up Ocean Boulevard.
Whether what is a problem?
The traffic is not as big a deal from the Ashworth up to Church Street.
Well, it's not unless you're trying to get off the beach.
When we put a policeman there, I can tell you I live near there. As soon as you put a policeman or you put a signal at that street to allow those cars to get out of here,
right?
You know, they move really fast.
Well, the problem is that, and I was fortunate enough when we were out there looking around to be there at the magic moment where a raindrop hit the beach, and the weather was, it was a beautiful day, and then, you know, a big cloud rolled in and the beach was packed. Mm-hmm. And we were parked down at the State Park beach, and so by the time, and it started kind of sprinkling when I got, we were walking from the Ashworth down toward the State Park. Got to the seashell and it started sprinkling. By the time we got down, got our car, came back up, there was a quarter mile queue at Church Street. And I suspect it's like that.
It is. But I'll tell you, if you have a light there, it'll change. And I'll tell you why, because I have to drive through that beach 10 times a day. As soon as that queue builds up, I stay in the right line, drive along the seawalk. As soon as I go by Church Street, I cross through the parking lot, I come back down. Now I have the right of way, I go into Church Street, and I'm gone.
Or go down to Winnicana.
Yeah, but lots of times I'm trying to, but you're right.
Because that's what I did.
You can go either way.
You don't do that, Bob.
Once you go, well, it's legal.
Well,
but it happens, and it holds those, it keeps them there because we all can keep cutting through.
Well, and the other thing that happens is that in inimitable New England fashion,
and I'll keep it to myself,
my mother-in-law is the kind of person, she is from Worcester. She grew up and she drives like she's from Worcester. And what she does is, if she's faced with a queue, she'll go in the unblocked lane right up to the head of the queue and cut in. You know, that's what she does. And you see that happening, at virtually every merge in New England. And that's why we have such a bad name. But what that does is it blocks that through movement so that, you know, I was still caught in a queue because of all these guys, all these people that were trying to, you know, sort of cut into the standing queue.
I don't think it happens there that much. I think it happens on the south end of Ashworth Avenue trying to go over the bridge. Mm-hmm. There's people going south. They see the two lanes. They don't know that those
trying
two
to get
lanes
to 136.
Come to one.
Yeah.
And they don't know when they get to the end that they have to go left. We made them do that.
Yeah, right.
The way the road is built, but it doesn't happen so much at Church Street.
Well, I mean, I hear what you're saying. You wouldn't be able to safely signalize either that intersection or the intersection at Highland without changing around that parking. Because incidentally, you know, what we're proposing, the changes that we're proposing would stop you from doing the cut-through. Because we don't like that either.
Okay, Mr. President, any other questions?
Yeah. I don't want to take up everybody else's.
All right. Rich?
Gordon, that one-way circulation pattern that is established now, is that going to be permanent?
You mean on the side streets?
All the alphabet streets.
It could be. I mean, it seems to be working fairly well.
It's usually in the summertime that was established, but then after the end of the season, they reverted to the alternate one way. Now, is it going to stay that way now, the way it is now, or is it going to go? Is it going to revert back to the alternate? Well, Mr. Preston's nodding his head. I don't know if you know.
I would think it would revert back.
Yeah, that's.
Is it going to?
Not really is.
Yeah. You've established that it's the circulation pattern now.
Well, the. Some of it depends on what, I mean, I don't really find a huge issue with it, but I don't drive it every day. If it reverted to alternating, really all that would affect is like whatever H through N Street.
Something like that.
You know, I mean, so it's not a big thing to me. I mean, one of the comments that we received was, you know, why don't we make all of the lettered streets one way west.
Ocean to Ashworth.
Yeah. So that you'd have to do, you know, if you wanted to circulate, you'd have to do the full loop. I don't know whether that makes any sense either. I mean, I think it works pretty well now and will in the future. I mean, our traffic volumes show poor levels of service if you measure them that way, but it doesn't necessarily, like an F on a side, on an unsignalized side street, F level of service F on a side street doesn't necessarily mean failure. It just means that it's an unsignalized side street. I think that we need to look closely, depending on what happens with Ocean Boulevard, at the impact on A Street or B Street. Because if you're kind of forcing everybody to go that way, that's something to be considered.
On your social media outreach, what was the average time or the time of the day that people left the beach? 4 o'clock, 5 o'clock?
Yeah, it was between 4 and 6.
And did the most of them go out of Church Street or over the bridge?
Well, I don't know that we asked that question, but the volume suggests that there are, I think it's 800 left turns, peak hour, PM peak hour at Church Street.
Church Street.
Which is a phenomenal number of turns. Hang on just a second, I can tell you.
Majority of people have to go over Seabrook.
What's that?
Majority of people go back through Seabrook.
They go back over the bridge, you think, more so than Church Street?
There are 615 left turns at Church Street in the PM, Saturday PM peak, which is actually maybe a little bit later than, you know, what we just, it's like 5:30.
Yeah. On the
and just so you know, there are 1,100 vehicles traveling southbound on Ashworth across the to the bridge.
That would make sense.
Yeah. So there are, it's actually pretty well split. There are 1,070 vehicles northbound at Church Street, so either making that turn or going up toward Winneconnet. And there are 1,125 at the State Park driveway.
You have to add the Brown Avenue left turns at Church Street to that.
And the Island Path.
The Brown Avenue getting out onto 101. Yeah, so it's the same thing as the left.
So rights on Island Path and rights on Brown Avenue.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
On the third proposal for Ashworth Ave to make it two-way, I'm just visualizing, if I'm coming over the bridge, heading north, and I want to go up either Ocean Boulevard or Ashworth, how am I going to cross over to get up Ashworth to go north without the traffic coming down in the westbound lane wanting to go around in front of me to go up Ashworth Ave, or go up Ocean Boulevard?
It would be a signalized intersection. So we would, I mean, we'd modify the geometry of that so that it's no longer, the through would be to Ashworth Avenue. It wouldn't be to Ocean.
So that means revamping that whole area and
correct
signalization.
Well, correct. And would that provide an opportunity to address some of the other safety issues down at that end of the Ashworth Ave there?
Yeah. I mean, there's some work to be done at that corner, that intersection, in front of Ocean Walk.
As it stands right now, you have essentially two lanes going into two lanes,
mm-hmm,
but there's this weird yield condition because people don't know what to do. So you could make some pretty minor modification. As it stands right now, if you did nothing else to any of the circulation patterns, you could do a pretty simple fix there, I think, to make both of those sort of free travel and clean up the movements. Right now, it's very confusing.
Okay, it works.
Rich,
yeah,
any others?
You're making that turn, because everybody coming north knows they have to get to the right, and it allows people to make
right
that turn and stay to the left.
Right.
You know, and I think that island in the middle is a problem. I've said it before. They're tired of me hearing it. But if you have two lanes of traffic going down Ashworth Avenue that goes to one to go over the bridge, you know, I think we're better off to try to keep two lanes to keep people going straight. It allows the people to get out of here. And then if you really had a problem and you want to empty out the beach, you just shut down the northbound traffic on the other side of the bridge, you'd have two lanes. You could dump thousands of cars on the other side, get them out of here. Once they get over on the south of the bridge, they behave better.
Yeah,
because there's no pedestrians. There's nothing to look at. They're gone.
Except the bridge will lift right in the middle when you look inside.
And I work on the south side of the bridge, so I see that. Yeah, all those lanes.
Well, the DOT is currently evaluating the bridge.
We know a guy.
You know a consultant.
I should say we are evaluating the bridge, and you know, under a separate contract with the DOT. So I'm not particularly involved with that, but I think that from what I understand, the high bridge is a difficult thing to.
It's too much money.
It's a
lot of money. We're better off fixing the boulevard than wait for that bridge.
I agree with you, but I'm biased. This is my project. That's not.
I guess the rest is more of a comment than a question. You mentioned about that truck being parked infringing on the pedestrians. Well, it's right back to the same issue that we've had right along. We need sidewalks, we need the road lowered, and establish sidewalks on both sides.
Right, right.
My second comment, you mentioned the idea of Highland Ave being two-way. Well, I'm being a little prejudiced here because I live on Highland Ave. Right. And I can't visualize outbound traffic going down Highland Ave, and all of a sudden you're meeting two lanes of traffic coming from Route 101, which means you've got to turn on Brown and onto Church.
Right.
And all you've done is split the bottleneck into two parts.
Well,
that's just my comment.
That is true. I mean, you have the same, at the end of the day, right there, you have the same volume of traffic. And, you know, we'll need to figure out how to accommodate that traffic the best way. We're trying to do all of this with as little property impact as possible. But to the extent that you can split things up, you have more options on how to deal with the traffic volumes that are left.
Well, it's just that you split it between Highland and Church, and then before and all, they have to meet up again. You know? Anyway. All right.
Well, but you're also adding Island Path and Brown into the mix. Absolutely. So.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Merrill, any comments, questions?
I'm just taking it all in. I'm trying to keep those parking spaces. But.
Yeah, right. Thank you.
Mr. Hausman.
Just wanted to know, will we get copies of that so we can get this report?
Yes.
You have it.
We do?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So,
mailed it?
Yeah.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah, William mailed.
The one you opened.
I emailed it. Yeah, you had about 7 documents that I sent yesterday.
All right. I was on the road, so I didn't see my... Yeah, thank you.
Okay. Mr. Griffin.
Yeah. I think it's a fascinating idea. I would think that it would help slow down the traffic in many ways, and I would just wonder, you know, how that would affect the whole problem. I mean, so many people complain to the town constantly about people speeding along Ocean Boulevard, particularly to the north there. And, I mean, we just get constant, it's so noisy with the motorcycles and this and that, so maybe this would stop some of that. But it certainly would be a big change, and I would see that it would cost a lot of money. So, but I think it's a unique plan that bears a lot of merit. Thank you.
Fran?
The 3-lane section on Ashworth, I can't see how it's going to work with all the left turns. You've got all the lettered streets, you've got all the west side streets, so you've got left turns coming and going from everywhere. Along Ashworth, you also have a lot of private drives,
right,
besides the streets.
Right, right.
So the number of, you know, entrances onto Ashworth Avenue is incredible. It seems to me you're going to get lefts in both directions. You don't have a lot of room between drives. There's no driveway control at all. If you drive Route 1 today, anybody with an out-of-state plate has no clue how to use that center turning lane. And many of the beach visitors are from out of state, and they don't know what that thing is, and they're in there this way, they're in there this way, they're blocking both lanes. I think loading is going to be a problem. You know, you got businesses you have to service on both sides of Ashworth as well. I just can't see how that's going to function as a 3-lane, 2-directional.
The loading issue is an issue, but I suspect that it's an issue today. But it's not as pressing an issue because you've got 2 lanes.
Right, and you can get by somebody now.
Well, the major loading would be from the Royal Market. I think the others have side streets and stuff that are...
Some of those side streets on the west, I don't think you want to be taking a truck at home.
See, the town already took a lot of those spaces. The town made them move parts of the buildings.
Right.
Already there.
Right.
And it was a big problem there at the Royal Market.
Right. Because that originally was going to be 3 lanes back when. and then they...
Well, and that was the recommendation out of the 2001 plan as well. And, you know, they were actually being a little bit more aggressive about it, and they had, I believe, a 50, I want to say it was a 56-foot cross-section for the roadway, and that's not going to fit anywhere. So you would have a taking along both sides of Ashworth Avenue the entire length. And I don't know, call me a pessimist, but I just don't see that ever happen.
When the town built that, they did it with the idea that it was going to be two ways.
Yeah,
exactly why it was built. That's why the poles are in the middle of the sidewalks, because that was the only way they could get it to be that width.
And you're absolutely right. The left turns are the issue. That's why you need the center turn lane, because otherwise it wouldn't work.
And that works great if you have some sort of driveway control, but they're just everywhere. I mean, the streets are everywhere. The streets aren't lined up.
Yeah.
You know, the west side streets don't line up with the east side streets. Right. Again, the private drives. I think you're going to have some serious problems with that. The other comment I have, it's sort of interesting, I never thought of it before. You talked about moving the parking basically north of Ashworth to the east. It's an interesting concept. The problem I see is more of a public relations problem. You're kind of taking the Ocean Drive and putting a parking lot there. Similar to what you, well, I'm just, well,
yeah, no, I hear what you're saying.
Operationally, I think it's probably a good idea.
Well, and I don't know, from my perspective, I think it would be, it gives you an opportunity to control pedestrian movements a lot better than are out there today. And it gives you an opportunity to do some improvement to the landscape setting of the roadway. So
it's user friendly.
Well, it's a lot more kind of intuitive to drive something like that than it is the current situation. And the traffic volumes don't necessarily, you know, they don't call for two lanes in each direction. So that could be contributing to why there's a speed problem there. Because, you know, the more pavement you've got with no cars around, the faster people are going to go. So so I hear what you're saying, but I think on balance, it would be a significant aesthetic improvement as well as a safety improvement.
Any other questions, Ray? Mr. Rage.
I like what Bob had said about eliminating that sidewalk, or maybe even making a smaller sidewalk there. I think the only place you couldn't do it would be in front of the playground, just because the playground's there.
Yeah, right.
But there is space on that other side. I don't ever see anybody on that sidewalk across the street. They're always on the beach, on the beach side, or they're on the boardwalk side. So I think that would make a lot more sense. Highland, I just can't see Highland working. I just don't think it's wide enough. Is there sidewalks on both sides in Highland?
Yes.
So could you eliminate one side of sidewalks?
We just got them. We got them a few years ago. Now you want to rip them out?
Because I'm going down that road, and I don't see two lanes down that road, even though it is two lanes.
We have parking there.
And there's parking.
Right.
So then if you eliminate more parking again, and I'm a broken record about parking. Parking is something that we're... We're in desperate need of, so that kind of makes me nervous on Highland. And then another thing, I'm just thinking, what if you eliminated turning onto Church Street and further down to that area at the end of before you turn to Boar's Head, there's kind of a dead area there. If you did a roundabout there and then brought people up to Church Street to leave. So instead of having a cut through,
so you'd go.
You go down, around,
down,
and then out.
Turn around, around the roundabout, come back.
So people could go north or they could go off that way.
You could build the jug handle.
Yeah.
Yep.
On the beach.
Well, right. Right.
Did you say that?
Considered. Actually, we considered that.
That's what Bobby does, yeah.
but I never actually drew it.
But if you drive down that way, you could see that. Eliminate that bottleneck, it would move people through. I don't know, I just think
so
that
So basically
might...
what you're suggesting is they then do a U-turn.
A U-turn. So your roundabout would kind of come either left or straight.
So we take about 10 car spaces away from...
No, there's not that many spaces there because there is a dead area where there's grass.
There's grass there.
Well, that's what a jug handler would do. You'd take it out onto the beach and line it up directly opposite Church Street and then take it straight across.
That might be
And that would be inexpensive. Well, nothing's inexpensive, but it would be less expensive. And it would... I mean, there's a lot of problems going on to Church Street, I think, so.
Okay. It's Church Street. Anything else?
Yeah.
Chuck, anything else?
No, I think that's... everybody else said everything.
Do you have your cap on as a commissioner?
And not my boss?
No. No, I'm not your boss, so you're... You know, as I sit here as a commissioner, it's easy for me to see some of the more, what I would call extreme examples that maybe some of the other people around the table are not seeing. Some of it's professionally based, some of it's because I'm not invested in this as much locally. And so people may not love my ideas as much. I love the concept of Ocean Boulevard being one lane. I think that that's a very drastic change from what people are used to. But if we want to have a serious conversation about bicyclist pedestrian safety and social media response and the first public meeting response and everything we seem to talk about talks about safety for bicyclists and pedestrians, the only way to do that effectively is to be fairly drastic in what we are used to seeing in the beach area. Along with that, knowing that there's a lot more work to be done to see if it can work, a two-way Ashworth, if that's the way it was originally thought of, would be quite a conversation for the state and the town to have about perhaps ownership and maintenance responsibilities swapping to let the state take responsibility for Ashworth.
Well, that was the original plan, and that was the very first year that I was selectman, and the idea was constantly being sold to us by Mr. Barrington that we would get it, we would trade the Route 1 or A1 road to go to the state, and then the town would take over Ocean Boulevard. And, you know, Mr. Barrington's idea was that where the parking is now, it would become development and more stores and things like that. That's what he saw as one of the possibilities, which, you know, we all were saying, well, the people that have the stores across the street that are there now are not going to be very happy, but he was looking at all the value that the town could get out of leasing those and becoming basically a landlord in that area. The different people that we were dealing with were telling us that it would be beneficial in many, many ways, and it would eliminate some of the traffic. So, you know, everyone thought it was a good idea, and everyone was sailing through with the idea until they put a warrant article, advisory warrant article on, and the public was not interested in doing it, the residents of the town of Hampton. It failed miserably. So after that, we stopped thinking like that, but the road was done to those specifications, and that is why there's some areas where there is just like a light pole right in the middle of the sidewalk, like over near your laundromat over there, there's some bad spots. And, you know.
Well, there's a part that by the parking lot there, there's a, I think it's a town-owned parking lot.
Yeah.
There's only like a 3-foot sidewalk, and it's got utility poles in it.
Yeah. Yeah, right in that area. And there were, like I said, some, there were at least two places where they had to remove part of the building. And the town was very interested in reclaiming what was theirs.
Yeah.
So,
okay.
So my question, and it's going to lead us to a conversation probably after you're done, Gordon, is I'm looking for opportunities
for this commission to get involved in our 10-year plan process. More than just the 250,000 or so engineering study that's in the draft 10-year plan today. So as you have done some of the work to date, you know, and I wrote down earlier the improvements at the end of at the south end of Ashworth, modest improvement there, or we're talking about the jug handle, or what could we do up by Church Street, other improvements there. Is there smaller scale work, low hanging fruit sort of, that we could go into the Gasset or the council hearings with? To say to Councillor Sununu, this study says that there are the preliminary results, the preliminary information from the study really point to some things that are going to need to be done regardless of any of these things that could get us moving forward sooner than,
you know, 5 years from now.
Yeah, it's going to be another 5, 7, 8 years from now before construction happens of anything that's in the 10-year plan today?
Well, I think there are. And as I think we were discussing before the meeting, you could look at many of these improvements as a phased kind of thing. I mean, as you indicated, you're going to need to do something at the south end of Ashworth regardless of which option we choose. And there may be a way to design that so that you could just like turn the signal heads around and, you know, either way it works out, it could be accommodated. Similarly, if the town and the state agree that the critical issue is the sidewalks on Ocean Boulevard, then, you know, maybe we could find a way to split that out and accommodate a future solution, you know, not really change things, traffic patterns and all of that in any big way, but and it may involve some compromises with regard to sidewalks or with regard to bike lanes or whatever, but make that improvement and make it in such a way that it'll accommodate a future, you know, dealing with the roadway. So we can certainly over the next little while, as we fine tune our cost numbers, we can, you know, potentially look at what we think the costs of those improvements might be. Because I mean, my sense is that, for example, on Ocean Boulevard, if you were just to look at the sidewalk issue, then, you know, you could probably do that for less than half of what the overall improvement would be. I mean, it would still be a decent amount of money, but at least it wouldn't be, you know, it wouldn't be $6 million. It would be maybe $2 or $2.5 million, and you could get something that I think would dramatically kind of shift the view and potentially lead to enhanced tax revenues and, you know, rooms and meals tax and all those good things that we talked about when we did the state park enhancements. So,
Gordon, let me move kind of some things around on the agenda because you're here and I'd like your input because I think this is a good segue. All of you have heard and some know directly that next Tuesday night, 7 o'clock, function room behind the Seashell stage. There is going to be a public hearing hosted by Governor Councilor Sununu on the transportation plan, the 10-year transportation plan. You also all know that right now we are in that 10-year plan, we meaning the town of Hampton. And you all should know, too, that we have $250,000 invested in the 10-year plan now. So I am looking at next week as yet now another opportunity for us to continue to build on that transportation plan to receive some more revenue. The original thought was, and from the sources that I've been talking with, the original thought was to go to Chris Sununu and say, we'd like you now to add some additional money over and above the $250,000 for Ocean Boulevard. And the number was 4 to 5 million. And that would then could be used down the road if and when we do the complete renovation of Ocean Boulevard. However, since then, I think Bill and others would suggest, which I tend to now start thinking to agree with, is that we might not have the opportunity because of the federal government and the way federal highway works, et cetera, to get a lump sum for everything. So it might be then a good idea to do it in phases. So if we were to take a look at going to the public hearing next week, saying that we would like, based on this study, we would like Project A or Project A and B to be considered as part of the phase approach of Ocean Boulevard. Now, my feeling is that we have some room of anywhere from $2 million to ask for, possibly up to $5 million, depending on some of the other projects that are in the 10-year plan now that might be on their way out. So if we were to take a look at a $2 to $5 million window of opportunity to start some of these projects, and when I say start, I think we're talking about 2018, possibly 2019. So in saying that, you know, if we were to take a look at even some of the things that we talked about tonight, let me share with you my number one, and everybody has some great ideas, and I can't disagree with any of them. But my number one concern right now is when you turn that corner on Ocean Boulevard at Havel Street and you pass up to McDonald's, to me that is the most dangerous and the most major impact of Hampton Beach today. Now, whether or not we look at the alternative that you provided, the one that Bob customized, or something along that way, I think if we can say, as a starting point, first of all, let's tear up Ocean Boulevard, bring it back down, talk about the sidewalks and drainage, which is a major issue. And if that number, whether or not we take parking from Dredd, we keep the parking and go with Bob's idea, or whatever that is, that doesn't have to really be considered right now. If we're just looking at taking Ocean Boulevard and bringing it down to the original level, sidewalks and drainage. Even if that section of Havel to McDonald's, that to me, whether or not that's a $2 million project, a $3 or $4 million project, I think, in my opinion, that's the most critical. I like the idea of the expansion of the sidewalk. I love the idea of it even being a little bit further out for trucks for delivery. And then whether or not you take that sidewalk on the east side, take it out, or find 68 spaces so that Dredd doesn't lose its parking to eliminate that parking. So in my opinion, that would be my, if I had to vote, that would be my priority to go into next week and say, we're looking for some funding to start Ocean Boulevard, and here's where we would want to start. That's my opinion.
Well, and my motto has always been, you got to be able to do something for $5 million. I think that's a very rational approach, and I would be, we'll have to run the numbers, but I would think that probably for south of $5 million, you could get, signal and intersection enhancements at the south end of Ashworth and, that section of Ocean Boulevard improved.
Yeah. Okay.
But it still doesn't, it still leaves some pressing issues.
Yeah.
And, I think that the, and there may be, we'll have to think about that, Mr. Chairman. I there may be an interim improvement that we could suggest at Church Street, if that kind of maintains the status quo, but
Well, what I would like to do, and I'm going to let Charlie speak in a minute, but what I would like to do to expedite the thought process of the commissioners here and you is, and I know today is Thursday night, and I know we only have 3 or 4 days until the meeting, but I do not want this meeting next Tuesday night to go without any type of input recommendation from this commission. So what I'd like to try to do is via email, and we'll get you something in writing, but via email is to kind of come up with a couple of options, you know, spread out between 2 and 5 million of all of the different things that we talked about, and see what the commission would identify as its top priority. And if we don't get all of that, say, top dollar, what would be the second priority? That way I could go in to the meeting next Tuesday night with something formal from this commission to present to Chris Sununu. How does that sound to the commissioners? Is that something that you think is workable? Mm-hmm. If we have an option to start thinking over the next couple of days, I'll work with Gordon, and we'll come up with a couple of options. I'll put them out to all of you, and we'll just take a head count vote in terms of what's priority one, priority two, priority three, and with the dollar amounts. And then we can go to Chris Sununu and say, okay, if you give us this amount, we can do this, but if you're only going to give us this amount, we can do this. So a fair way to look at it?
Just for clarification, is this money, where's the money coming from? What's the source of the funding?
So right now, you know, the funding would be part of our normal federal highway dollars that we're getting every year.
Okay.
We're going through a 10-year plan update. Tonight was meeting number 8 of 16.
Right.
We go through that whole process. One of the things that we've seen with Councilor Sununu is that he takes a hard look at the projects that are in the 10-year plan already. We've taken a very hard look in the draft update at minimizing extraneous projects that have reached their useful life or never will reach a useful life, to try to remove some, try to delay some others that are lower priorities. And I think that if the commission had an opportunity to try to convince the counselor that there was he knows there's a concerted effort going forward in the master plan update. He knew it wouldn't get the project to construction on its own. That's why 2 years ago he proposed putting the $250,000 in as a placeholder to take engineering further. If this commission came up with an idea that's based on some of the work that's been done to date, that can build upon our work and build upon what he's already set as a placeholder with an expectation that there's going to be construction at some point down the line, he'd be willing to look at those projects either within his region or throughout the state that have a less likely chance of succeeding, and saying maybe let's delay or remove some of those other projects to make room for this.
Okay.
And that's part of the we've put together a recommendation from the department's perspective, and this is one that we have a hard time coming to terms with without having some of the local support, trying to make sure we make the right recommendations. And so having this commission that represents state and local interests come forward to Chris would be a good opportunity. But it would be forcing us to reprioritize some of what's already there in the next 10-year plans, delaying or pushing some out.
Okay. Well, I can certainly take a look at what we've done to date and kind of parse those numbers and see if I can come up with some answers for you, Mr. Chairman.
All right.
And potentially I can do that tomorrow.
Okay, great. Charlie, I'll let you speak for just whatever you want.
Yeah, Mr. Chairman, the audience has been very quiet and patient tonight for an hour and 50 minutes.
Give me 60 seconds.
Well, right. Yes, I'll be done.
I just wanted to say, I agree with some things my brother said, Rich Rainier said, Chuck said, because I'll say they have more skin in the game virtually where they live and where they do business. I wholeheartedly agree with Fran McMahon. your RCP rep, okay? I think Ashworth Ave being two-way is, you know, I've been against it forever. Left-hand turns, I thought, in the industry were pretty much taboo, okay? But the way I look at this, you are creating, and I don't know the exact distance, but from the Ashworth to the Ocean Walk, maybe a mile, you're creating 28 left-hand turns by the leaded streets and the back streets, plus what Fran said, the driveways. Plus you got the center turning lane where one of us is heading north, one heads south. And next thing you know, we have a fire truck or a police truck both coming at us, and we're looking at each other. Where do I go? Okay. When the Cecil Group did this plan originally, I said to them, do you remember the Dodgems? He goes, yeah. I said, do you remember there was one rule with the Dodgems? No head-on bumping. Okay. If you make this two-way, not only do you have those 28 left-hand turns, all the driveways, like Fran said, the center lane with people trying to turn with police and fire both jamming them up, you have accidents, you have reconstructions. All of a sudden, you could have that whole beach shut down. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Okay, so setting the ground rules. Gordon and I, along with Bill, will talk over the next day or two. We'll come up with a couple of priority one, two, and three. This is the cost of that priority. I'll do a vote, and the vote will be majority. And as long as we have a good majority vote on priority one, two, and three, that's what we'll go with at the meeting on Tuesday night. Is that fair?
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Good.
Before we let Gordon go, he did ask us to try to...
Oh, an update on the...
Get a date.
Get a date for a public meeting.
Yep. Okay. So, Gordon.
Yes, sir.
Do you have, first of all, do you have any suggestions before we all look at our calendars?
For dates for the meeting, I was thinking at least 2 weeks from now. And so the dates that I put forward to William were, let me just bring my calendar.
7th or 8th of October?
8th of October, yes. 7th or 8th of October, and actually 7th might be better than 8th because I was informed that Carolyn can't make it on the 7th. I mean, on the 8th.
Mr. Rose can make it on the 7th?
Yes.
Okay. Gentlemen,
planning
the 7th?
Planning board
meeting?
I mean, the last meeting we did was on a Thursday night, and I thought it was pretty well attended.
But you said she can't come on the 8th?
She can't come on the 8th, so that would, you know, the next one is the 17th. Or the
15th.
Which is zoning, isn't it? Zoning board on the 15th?
Is that a Wednesday?
No, it's a Thursday.
Thursday.
Yeah. The precinct meeting's on the 14th.
13th?
13th
is Tuesday night.
Tuesday? That works for me.
Bill, 13th?
None of us are superstitious, are we?
But that's okay.
What about Mr. Rose?
It should work for him.
13th? 13th?
Should we make a tentative and you confirm with us?
Okay. Why don't we go with the 13th and I'll confirm.
That's the day after Columbus Day.
Yes.
Yeah.
7?
Yeah, 7 o'clock.
7.
Yeah.
Huh?
7 o'clock.
7, oh, yeah, 7, 7 o'clock here. Yeah.
I'd have to check if the room's available.
Okay. The 13th. Yep. All right.
That's a Tuesday?
That's a Tuesday.
Could be the budget
Probably
committee.
The budget committee, right?
I was going to say that, yeah.
They'll be meeting every day.
And if it's not them, it's the school.
I would have to find another meeting.
Either the school or the budget committee.
So if we can...
Location? Yeah. I mean, we can find a location.
We can use ours if there is a police station.
To
yours? Oh, we can go to the police station. So we'll find a location.
Yeah. Okay.
So let's tentatively plan the 13th.
Okay.
7 o'clock.
Okay. And...
And why don't you and I confirm within the next couple of days so then you can do your...
Yeah, we'll post it on the Facebook page and all of that. I mean, and it would be good to have a location.
Okay.
That we can post as well.
And Gordon,
One question that I had, and maybe I can sort of take this up with William as well. How much of this documentation do you want to post on the web?
I think what you posted today, I mean, what you presented today, I think it's critical.
Okay.
I think it's critical for people. And the thing is that as people are watching tonight and will see the retape of this, we have to tell them to go to the web. If they want to really understand what you presented to this group here tonight.
Because we can post, you know, we've got a section on the website that we have that we can post whatever we want.
Yep.
And, you know, I would be in favor of that as well. But, you know, I just wanted to make sure that
I would take your presentation tonight and post it right on the web.
What about the memoranda as well?
No, just the just your presentation.
Okay. That's easily done.
Yep. Okay. And while you're here, Gordon, let me just jump to another agenda item under old business, and that was the agreement that we are the relationship we had established in the month of August with the Hampton Police Department.
Oh, right.
We had, as you all know, the special meeting which authorized us to donate $4,000 towards the cost, which is was approximately 50% of the cost of adding law enforcement into four different intersections down on the beach. It was done on Friday night, Saturday, and Sunday. I actually had the opportunity to observe a couple of those nights and days, and I know others also did. In talking with Chief Sawyer, he also received a lot of positive comments about how the traffic flowed. You know, talking to three or four business owners right on Ocean Boulevard, their comments too was that it was remarkable and how things were flowing. Not only cars, but people. So I think it was very productive. I think it gives us a good indication to no matter what we do and all the rest of the stuff that we're doing is traffic control, pedestrian control, I think, or traffic flow and pedestrian control, I think, have to go hand in hand. A couple of things that we discovered, which Rich Sawyer is already taking into consideration for next summer, is that there were a couple of things that people didn't realize. At least this brought it out. A good example was right at CDE, the intersection of Ocean and E, where the boardwalk is. There was one police officer there, and he was controlling traffic from north south to north and controlling people crossing east to west. What we noticed, which would be a fix for next time, is that is a very popular turn down street. So traffic was wanting on the left side, heading north, was wanting to go down that street, but couldn't because the people were constantly crossing the street. Mm-hmm. People crossing the street constantly was creating that traffic backup on the left side of Ocean Boulevard. So that was
F Street.
F Street.
That's the crosswalk.
I thought there was an
Charlie
E Street.
Charlie wants an E Street, but it's fine.
So that was one thing. And then the other thing, in terms of pedestrian safety, and everybody noticed it probably more because there were two police officers at McDonald's. And one was controlling the traffic coming up, and one was controlling traffic going north, and the pedestrians on both walkways. So as the cars started to get out of that traffic jam and started to go further up Ocean Boulevard, they had to slow down. And the reason they slowed down was that all of the fast foods right along there, Sal's Pizza, Boardwalk, up to the candy store, that yellow line that we laugh about, there were people far to the east of that yellow line.
Oh, yeah.
So that even when you get past McDonald's and you can now start moving again, you can't, because now there are people out on the street. So it actually goes into one lane.
From the food?
Yes, they're
counter.
Waiting in line.
Oh, wow.
And their line is west to east.
Yeah, right.
So
right.
One of the things that the chief talked to us about, and he's going to want a meeting between us and the Village District, is to put into some type of decorative gating system where that yellow line is. So it's actually going to keep people confined within a fencing. And you can use the fencing in a decorative way, even maybe some...
It may not even need to be fencing. I mean, it could be bollards with, you know, a nautical theme.
Yep.
It could be any number of things.
Yep.
It just needs to be a barrier. And I don't know if you've ever been to Las Vegas. That's a place where they have some serious pedestrians. And...
We should go.
And you cannot, we should do a
make
field
a familiarity trip.
You
fam trip.
But on Las Vegas Boulevard, which is the strip, you cannot, as
we
a pedestrian,
in the
cross that road. They have fences up on both sides. They have a fence in the middle, and there's nowhere to go. The only way you can cross is at overpasses.
Yeah.
And
I said this years ago because I remember going to Fort Lauderdale, and they had barriers, Jersey barriers, which are ugly, but these were all decorative with flowers and arrangements
and
stuff, and it was all along, and if you went in front of the casino, I would say from F Street to probably C Street,
right,
with this type of thing, and had an opening at the crosswalks,
right,
where they could only cross that way, it would make a huge difference. I said that 25 years ago, I'd
say. And it did work over the 4th of July.
And they did it over the
4th. Because they had that fencing up, and it kept everybody confined.
Yeah.
You know, not drifting out into the middle of the road.
Right.
So saying that, the we did take a vote to support this by 4,000. So I will be asking Mike to issue out a check for $4,000 to the town of Hampton. Chief Sawyer did send a letter. I won't read the whole letter, but basically, he did bring in a training program to quickly train some younger members of his team. Basically, there were a number of officers assigned to different streets. With the addition of these officers to work in traffic control capacity, was able to continue a program through the end of the summer of 2015. The entire program met with positive feedback from the community. Based upon this success, it's my intention, Budget and Staffing Committee, to continue this program going into next summer. All too often, people will identify a problem but are unwilling to participate in the efforts to a solution. I want to thank the Commission for your generous donation to the town of Hampton to help offset the cost of this program. The Beach Commission continues proactive approach and willingness to participate in problem solving and improving Hampton Beach experience for all to be commended. The other good news about this was that, as you know, we have to always look for different in-kind contributions for matching for our $300,000 grant. And with the help of William Rose, we were able to get it included, this pilot project included as in-kind. So whatever the police department spent from its budget on this pilot project will be considered in-kind. And would be put towards our total grant. So that was a good piece of news. Saying that, Gordon, I think that is it for you. You can more than happy to stay and listen to the rest of the meeting, but I think we've covered everything we wanted.
Okay.
And why don't you and I connect tomorrow?
Okay, that sounds terrific.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, all of you. I appreciate the input. And I appreciate your patience with us.
Okay, moving right along, Chairman's report. I only have one thing to discuss, and that is this. I'm going to put it on the table tonight. Doesn't require a whole lot of discussion, but just as a starting point, I would like to, over the next couple of months, start the process of the Beach Commission and State Parks to seriously look into submitting in a proposal
to the 2017 New Hampshire capital budget process. That was the capital budget process that we got our $14.5 million. I would like to start looking at the feasibility of going back to the state of New Hampshire through its capital budget and look for additional funding for the South Beach entranceway of coming into Hampton, which will also include the South Beach State Park. I had a preliminary conversation with Commissioner Rose, and he is open for discussions and partnering. Have to kind of really think about what we would propose. I've already talked to Ward Delia, who has had some of the original plans, because if you recall, that was the phase of our major project back in 2009 that was not funded. And so what I'd like to do is have the Beach Commission once again spearhead, in cooperation and partnership with State Parks, to start the process of looking at what we could do to improve the State Park and the entranceway of Hampton Beach through the capital budget process. Would there be any objections to that? Okay. Then, Michael, I'm going to ask that we coordinate a meeting between maybe at this point you, Phil, myself, Ward Delia, and a couple of other players,
mm-hmm.
Brian Wilson maybe.
Yeah, Tom Mansfield probably.
Tom
yep.
Mansfield, mm-hmm. just to kind of have a sit around and say, okay, if we wanted to think of a concept that we could get approved in Concord, what would that concept
yep,
be?
Yep, very good.
Okay?
Mm-hmm.
All right, thank you. Treasurer's report.
So we're looking at, you know, we ended May with a balance of $16,449.42 is where we sit today.
And so with that $4,000 donation, it'll be down to a little over 12.
Yep, 12.4.
Okay. All right. I have a motion to accept the treasurer's report. Motion made by Mr. Watson.
Yes.
Second by Mr. Preston. All in favor?
Aye.
I also have, I need a motion. We have a bill from the town of Hampton for secretarial services from January of 2015 to July of 2015, total of $610. Do I have a motion to approve? Motion made by Mr. Dean Merrill and second by Rich Renier. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Okay. Okay, old business. We already talked about the traffic flow pilot project. South Beach entrance. Ann was kind enough to run off some copies. And there's not enough. But that's okay. I think I have some.
Yeah,
right. Now, as you know, we didn't have any monthly meetings in the summer months, but we were very active as a beach commission. And one of the things that we were very active in was we actually had what I would call semi-public meetings hosted by the Beach Commission, but attended by anywhere from 12 to 15 organizations that had something to do with Hampton Beach. And those organizations not only were local organizations, but state and region. And a lot of the discussions that came from that was looking at how do we improve the South Beach entranceway coming into Hampton. And it was a great experience because, as you can see, there was a lot of individuals involved. And we talked about kind of low-hanging fruit, some things that we should be able to do right away, some things that we would look at as more of kind of tier two, where it would cost some money.
And then long-term, some of the things that we wanted to do as improvements that really would require either federal, state, grant money. Saying that, I am going to reconvene this group again in October, now that the summer is over, and actually start putting a work plan together of some of these things that we can look at going into next spring. One of the things that came out of those discussions, the two discussions that we had, has to do with both DRED and DOT. And one of the major areas of concern and areas of recommendation is really three things. One is having an official crosswalk from the state park side over into that middle area going over to all the fishing retail stores. We all know from discussions that we've had with Bill that that's going to require somebody, for us to convince somebody at DOT to say we need that crosswalk, and therefore we also then need some curbing on the west side of Ocean Boulevard with handicap accessibility so that we can actually put a crosswalk on. So that was one thing that I think the majority, if not everybody, said this was a priority to them. The second priority also has to do with DRED and DOT, and that is that if you cross over the bridge from Seabrook, if there was a way where we could take land from state parks, a little bit of land, create a turning lane into the state park, that would move traffic a lot better than where it is now. Because what's happening is as the cars come across, and if there's a backup going into the state park, all of the cars on that right side of that two lanes is backed up. If you could create a turning lane from the bridge to the entranceway of the state park, that would then that would move some of the traffic that way, and then the rest of the traffic could go straight on. So those would be some of the things that I think could be done, but it's going to take the cooperation of both DRED and DOT along with the local community. So what I would like to do is to, as showing good faith that we as a commission want to really work with this group to help them try to clean up that area, I think this would be a great opportunity for us to sit with DOT and DRED and say, all right, how can we do these two things? How could we put a sidewalk with curbing on the left side, and how do we do a turning? So I don't know what other people. Bob, you've been involved in all of those meetings. Chuck, you had been involved in some of them. Any comments on just those ideas or any others?
Yeah, taking that lane going in would help a little bit, give them parking for 4, 5, 6 cars to wait. You know, and I think we talked about it last time, if there was a way at the ticketing booth to allow, when they get busy, to do both sides if they had somebody. I want to say the entrance of the place looks really nice with the changes and all those trees gone. You know, it's opened that up a lot, which I think will make it easier for people that are coming south wanting to go in there. They can see what's happening a little better. Mm-hmm. Regarding the crossway, for safety reasons or whatever reasons, I think there's a lot of people that like the concept of us crossing the street there. I can tell you from some highway people I've talked to, not Mr. Watson, and talking to the Port Authority, they don't like that idea of people walking across there. Now, earlier we talked about changing some signals at Ashworth Avenue at the point. Maybe if we can get people to walk down a little further, cross over, it's a much safer area, and then they can cut back. At least we're controlling, you know, pedestrians in that area.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think one of the recommendations that came from this group was that if there was a crosswalk, it would be north of the entranceway, not south. So closer to what you're saying.
Yeah, saying we might end up moving
by where the Marianne is, or
yeah, by, yeah,
just before their parking.
Yeah.
Yeah, but that's such a...
Huh?
That would take a lot of doing just with the crosswalk, too, because that's such a congested area, too.
Well, I think it's worth examining. I think everybody agrees that south of the entranceway is not a good idea at all. Mm-hmm. And especially if we can get the approval and work done of creating that turn-in lane. But people are crossing now. And it's just a matter of, you know, do you continue to let them cross anywhere from the bridge down to the hotel? Or do you try to create at least an area where, you know, you're saying, all right, here's where the crosswalk is. If you're going to cross here. I don't know. I think it's worth a discussion.
Mm-hmm.
So
you got four lanes to run across.
Yeah. So, all right. Well, I will keep everybody up to date on that. But I think it's been a very good group. And I think the Beach Commission has gotten a lot of good stuff, positive stuff. I know that Mr. Preston provided on behalf of the commission a luncheon to kick this thing off at the beginning of the summer. And I think the people that were involved, once again from the state and the local, really appreciated the Beach Commission's involvement in this.
One of the good things I noticed at that meeting was how well Parks and the town of Hampton, DPW, worked. Mm-hmm. Those guys got right together. Forget about talking to all the bosses. They worked right together to try to figure out what's best for both of them.
Okay.
That was the same with the snow removal.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah. Yep.
Is there any other old business? The only other old business that I have, and it's just a request to Mr. Watson, to Mr. Rose, because I don't want to drop this, is that in the minutes of May, I had requested from Mr. Rose to give us what it would cost as a change order for Gordon and his group to take a look at Boar's Head up to at least Winnicunnet, and if all the way up to High, including King's Highway. Never got that in terms of, and whether or not this could be a phase two, but I am as concerned with the business community and the residents from Boar's Head, Little Boar's Head, up to High Street. And you know, from a sidewalk perspective, you take a look at as you go around the bend over to Rick's place, all the way up there, that should deserve some review because it's in the master plan and we can't ignore it. And whether or not it was, you know, somebody dropped the ball in the very beginning not to include it, I don't know, it's water over the dam, but I'd like to Mr. Rose to come back to us and say, we can make this as a phase two if you're willing to add X amount of dollars towards the grant to do this. Is that okay? Okay. And then the other thing, just to put a close to it, some of you attended, we did have a seawall, North Beach seawall dedication. It was completed, and on the 22nd of June, it was a very good day. Had a number of people show up. The Hampton Historic Society made a presentation of what the seawall looked back in the 1800s all the way up to the present. So it was a good event, and I'm glad that the Beach Commission co-sponsored it with State Parks. New business. Just want to make sure that everybody has, and I brought some extras, just in case, your calendar for September through next May. I have it here. If anybody needs it, I'll just leave it out here. And the other thing is, Chuck, I will need from the Hampton Beach Village District a decision in the month of October. You have one member, Rich, that is up for his position is up in October. So I will need something from the Village District on that. I will have to go to the town of Hampton because I am up next month. And then the third is the Commissioner at Large. We'll have to revisit that also in October. So those three positions will have to be addressed in the month of October. Okay? Mr. Preston.
It may be premature, but if we're going to talk about changing the Commissioner at Large position, I would hate to have people think that, you know, from my perspective, that I'm interested in entertaining someone else. I think Dean has done a great job here. I think he did a good job going to Concord, working out those issues we had up there. He has a good perspective with the Chamber of Commerce and everything. So I'm wholeheartedly in support of Dean staying on the board.
Okay, well, then I would suggest that in October, when we meet in October, for you to make that motion. And if we have a second and then a decision, that would be fitting.
Now, yours is up in October, so I'll get that put on the agenda coming up.
Yeah, because they might want to, you know, put it out for candidates and stuff. Okay. Any other new business? I would encourage everybody to come to the transportation meeting next Tuesday night, 7 o'clock. You will hear from me within the next 48 hours with regard to some options for that meeting. And our next meeting is scheduled for October 22nd. I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
Okay.
Mr. Preston made a motion. Mr. McMahon second. All in favor?
Yo.
Okay. Channel 22, thank you.
Bye now.